Hello again, GV Christian Center. I'm here to write some more thank you notes today. So, Brent, please play me some good thank you note writing music. Perfect. Thank you, Facebook, for making me believe I actually might have 200 friends. Thank you, neighbor who pays for internet but doesn't put a Wi-Fi password on, for basically paying for my internet as well. Thank you, cookie dough, for being two of my favorite things, dessert and not having to cook dessert. Well, those are some of the things that I'm thankful for. Now, we can all see how we can all be a little more thankful.
Yeah, all right. You already get the vote for being the best service of the weekend. We'll see how it goes at 11. Last night they were, don't tell them, you know, it's just between us, but they were not good. But it was a three-day weekend, so who knows what was happening. But I was glad that they were here last night, and I'm glad that you're here. And I really am, and I'm thankful for them. You got to have fun and laugh at each other. And they would laugh if I were to tell them that. Next weekend they would laugh, but not last night. They wouldn't have laughed. But I love that you're in church today because you're in the right place. And even if you're listening online, I am so glad that you're joining us this weekend. And it's not like being here live, is it? To be in God's presence, in God's house, and with His people. And you have the opportunity to make a decision for just over 30 days or so during the series called Thank You Notes. And that is this, to make a list and to make a commitment to make a list and to write out every day of things that you're thankful to God for. And so we began last weekend, things that you would just be thankful to your spouse for. Maybe it's been a long time since you told your spouse thank you for being you and what you do and who you are. And the list goes on and on. Thank you to your kids if you're parents, and to your grandkids if that fits. And the list goes on and on. There's so much to be thankful for. So this weekend, we're going to continue this series called Thank You Notes. And as this series continues, I'm going to mention to you from time to time the best research in the land, people that are a lot smarter than I am and have done a lot of research about the benefits of being a grateful person, that it literally remaps your brain, because being grateful, it's so huge, and the Bible talks about it over and over again. Now, here's a question for you. What's the one thing that people don't have in Henderson and the Las Vegas Valley? You know what it is? Here it is. The one thing that people don't have in Henderson and in the Las Vegas Valley is this: enough. Enough. It's the one thing that most people don't have. Enough. I mean, just look at the, did anybody see some of the news clips or some of the pictures in the paper about people lined up, I think, between the two lotteries, $1.6 billion. Yeah, wow, is right. I mean, they were lined up to buy those lottery tickets. You know, why would you want $1.6 billion given to you? Because you don't have enough, right? And you don't have enough. And you hope that you win because you tell yourself that if you won, you would give a big chunk of it to God. So, I know how that works. And so, you know, so years ago, we had this guy in our church, and he came up to me, and he said, and there was a big jackpot, and this was several years ago, it was a big jackpot at the time, but he told me that God, he had this ticket, he said God told him that he was going to win the lottery, and that if he won, that he would give a big chunk of it to God and to GV Christian. And so I said, you know, God just spoke to me and told me that you should give me that ticket. No, I didn't say that to him. I didn't say that to him, but I wanted to. But he did tell me that. And so that next week, I was talking with another pastor on the other side of the valley. And I forget the context of the conversation, but he happened to mention me. And he said, hey, this guy came up to me in my church. And he said, he had bought a lottery ticket, and he said God spoke to him. And that he was going to win the lottery, and if he did, he would give a big chunk to the church that he attended. And I said, huh, that's funny. Because someone in my church said the same thing. Now, a couple of more questions. Do you think that they also had in mind anything that they were going to spend it on besides giving to God? The answer is?
Yes.
Yeah. Now, guess which church received a big check in the offering after the lottery? Neither. Sure. So here's another question. Was it God who told them, or was it wishful thinking? It was wishful thinking. Why? Because people don't have enough. And God has the anecdote for never having enough. It's called being thankful. And it's an attitude of gratitude. And it literally remaps the brain. Because research and study after study has proven it again and again. And there's a very close first cousin to gratitude, and it's this: contentment. And the Bible has a lot to say about contentment, so we're going to take a look at that. And one of the biggest enemies of gratitude is contentment. So in just a few moments, we're going to turn to Philippians chapter 4, so you may want to scroll on your mobile devices. Or turn your Bibles to Philippians chapter 4. So one of the biggest enemies, once again, of gratitude is contentment, because, you know, there's just not enough fun. There's just not enough happiness. There's not enough joy. There's not enough free time, or not enough resources or money. And the average study says this, that no matter what income level that you are at, no matter what income level, that people say this: if I just had $1,000 more a month, then I would have enough to pay my bills. And so that's across the board. No matter if it's a six-figure income or less than that, or higher. You know, just $1,000 more a month, then I would have enough. So whatever you want to fill in the blank, whether it's joy or happiness, free time, whatever it is. So in the context of money, a guy by the name of Solomon, he had incredible wealth. Comparatively speaking, it was in the billions upon billions and billions of dollars, much more than Warren Buffett or Bill Gates, comparatively speaking, in today's dollars. But he said this, because Solomon, he was really searching for some kind of contentment in life. And he explored everything from education to pleasure to sex to, you know, money. And he pursued it all. When it came to the subject of money, he said this. We'll come back to Solomon here, but the reference is in your note sheet. Solomon said this in Ecclesiastes 5. Whoever loves money never has money enough. Whoever loves wealth is never satisfied with his income. This too is meaningless. As goods increase, so do those who consume them. And what benefit are they to the owner except to feast his or her eyes on them? And so he was really exploring this. So this is what we're going to do. We're going to dispel some of the common misconceptions about what being thankful and content really means, and then what God actually has to say about being content. So, and then we're going to have some practical take-home stuff. So Philippians chapter 4, you've turned to it, classic text, if you will, on contentment, verse 10, Philippians 4, verse 10. And keep in mind now that we're sitting, I want you to picture yourself sitting behind Paul as God is speaking to him, and we're looking over the shoulder of Paul as he's writing a letter to the church in a city called Philippi. We call it Philippians. So he's writing this letter to the church at Philippi, and Paul is under imprisonment. He is under house arrest. This is known as one of the prison epistles. The word epistle just means a letter. So this is one of the letters that Paul writes, prison letters that Paul writes while he is incarcerated by the Roman Empire at his own request, while he is waiting to appeal and to go to court, if you will, before Caesar, the Roman emperor, because Paul was a Roman citizen. So Paul says this under house arrest. I rejoice greatly in the Lord, verse 10, I rejoice greatly in the Lord that at last you have renewed your concern for me. Indeed, you have been concerned, but you had no opportunity to show it. I'm not saying this because I am in need, for I have learned. Everybody say learned. To be content. You ought to circle those two words, learned and content. And then he says this, whatever the circumstances, I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned. So now Paul changes the text of this, the tense of this a little bit. Now he's reinforcing it. He says, I get it. Not that he has arrived, but he says, I get it. He said, I've learned. Now I get it. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. And then he says this, I can do everything through him who gives me strength. This verse is often taken out of context, this last verse that I read, and it was well-meaning and well-intentioned people, but they'll say this. Maybe you saw some of the championship teams. I didn't hear anybody say this, but they may have said, they walk out on the field, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Or heading into a new job, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Now, is that true? The answer is yes, it is true. But it has to do with being content regardless of the outside circumstances, as we have just read. That's what it means. So we'll unpack it just a little bit here once again. So how does the Bible define contentment? Well, we already read it, but here's the first thing. It's something that is learned and not acquired. It's something that is learned and not acquired. We just don't come by contentment naturally, do we? And we learn one step at a time, not giant leaps. It's a daily walk. And here's why. Because I was perfectly happy until I saw yours. And all of a sudden, I want one. I was perfectly happy with my salary until I saw your salary. And I was perfectly happy with my position until I saw your position. And after all, I deserve that position. And so the list of examples can go on and on. Now, I love this verse. The reference is in your note sheet. It says this in Colossians 3. Whatever you do, it, whether in word or deed, so in other words, your actions or what you speak, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. So whatever we do it in Jesus' name. Why? Because when you step across the line into a personal relationship with God through Jesus Christ, you are his representative. Paul is chained once again to the elite Roman guards. They were, if you will, the secret service, the special op troops of the emperor himself, because Paul was a Roman citizen. Paul, obviously, he wants out of this house arrest, but he's coping with it within. Why? Because of the strength that Jesus is giving him. And as much as he doesn't want to be in that situation, he has learned to be content, regardless of the outside circumstances. And he begins to share the good news with the elite. In fact, in Philippians chapter 1, he talks about it. He says, look, I thank God for these chains, because if it weren't for these chains, I wouldn't have the opportunity. And because I'm able to cope within, rather than complaining, I'm grateful. I'm rejoicing in it. Even though I don't want to be here, I'm rejoicing in it, and it's opened the door for me to share this good news about Jesus Christ to these elite guards. I'm so thankful for it. So Paul said, and he reinforces it, this is something that I have had to learn to do. So number two, biblical contentment, first of all, is learned and not acquired. Number two, it's learning godly coping skills and accepting what cannot be changed. Yeah. It's learning godly coping skills, but accepting what can't be changed. So what is God saying? With Jesus' strength living on the inside of me, I can cope with the way things are. I can cope with being well fed. I can cope with being hungry. I can cope because Jesus gives me strength when I ask, when I ask him for strength, that he'll give me that strength no matter if I have a lot or if I have nothing at all. And when I find myself in a situation that I don't like, in fact, a situation that I might hate, I can cope. Jesus led the way in this. Jesus found himself on the cusp of his crucifixion. And he was in a garden. And three times he prayed, God, would you please let this cup pass from? He didn't want to die. He was in the prime of his life. He knew what it was to live life to the fullest and to be thankful. Three times he asked, God, please let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but your will. He was relying on the strength and being obedient to what God wanted him to do, and he submitted to it. And he plugged into the strength through the power of God. When I find myself in a situation that's not good, I can cope like Jesus in the garden. The list of those examples go on and on and on. So that's, in a nutshell, that is biblical contentment and gratitude, two very close cousins. Now, let's take care of some misconceptions that a lot of people have when it comes to contentment, because here is what biblical contentment is not. You ready for it?
Yeah.
Okay, three of you. I'm going to tell you anyway. So, so biblical contentment is not happiness. It's not happiness. So Paul's not saying, you know what? I love this situation that I'm in. I love being under house arrest. He's not saying that at all. He's not saying, I love having nothing. And I am so happy being in a Roman prison. You remember that it's Paul also who wrote, and he had some kind of a physical ailment or something that was really attacking him physically, emotionally, spiritually. We don't know what it is, but it, you know, Paul called it a thorn in his flesh. And I know that some of you would say, oh, well, I know what that is. You can email somebody, but not me, because, you know, because the Bible says we don't know what it is. And so Paul too, he says, he asks and he prays to God three times, would you please set me free from this thorn in my flesh? And the answer that God had was no. But he had learned, even when he was in situations that he hated, God gave him coping skills from within, regardless of the outside circumstances. Contentment is not happiness. And it may come as a surprise to some of you, but God is more concerned about your eternal life and your spiritual and emotional growth and maturity than he is your happiness for the moment. You can be biblically content, but hate the situation that you're in.
That's right.
And trusting in the power of God. Number two, biblical contentment is not a lack of ambition or drive or laziness. Now, Jesus had great ambition. In fact, Jesus said this. In fact, just the fact that Jesus became one of us, God in the flesh, the second person of the Godhead, he became one of us. That takes a tremendous amount of ambition. The Bible says that he emptied himself. He left heaven, and he came and became one of us without sin, perfect, but he became one of us. In fact, Jesus had such ambition that he said this to his disciples as he was returning to heaven. He said this. He said, go into all the world, not just Jerusalem. Would you agree that's ambition? He said, go into all the world and make disciples. Tell them about the good news and baptize them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost. That is tremendous ambition. Paul a person of great ambition. Wasn't lazy at all. Pete had great ambition. In fact, Pete owned a fishing business. And when Jesus was crucified, he went back to that. He thought that it was over. He didn't realize the full import that Jesus said, look, on the third day I'll raise again. He didn't get that. It wasn't until he saw Jesus. He knew that Jesus was dead. So he went back to his fishing business, and it was a good, thriving business. They were all men of great ambition, but with contentment and character. Now, it's okay if you're not driven, or that it's okay if you have, if you're driven, or if you have high ambition, because we're all wired differently. In fact, we see this all the way through the Word of God. There was a guy by the name of Jabez, and the reference is in your note sheet. And Jabez, he prayed this prayer. He said, God, would you bless me? And would you expand? And he used agricultural terms. He said, would you expand the pegs of my tent? In other words, he was asking God to bless him financially. And it's an amazing prayer. Somebody wrote a book, and I knew about the prayer of Jabez before somebody wrote a book about it, a simple little book called The Prayer of Jabez. But it was a prayer to ask God to bless him financially. And this is what the Bible says. God granted his prayer request. And he was blessed financially. The point is this. It's not about ambition or lack of it. It's about being thankful. And the fact of the matter is that without ambition, I mean, this church wouldn't be here. There'd be no school, no growth groups. There'd be no place to gather and to worship God on this hill without ambition.
Yeah, that's right.
So that's what biblical contentment is not. Now, why is contentment so elusive then? How can it be so elusive? Well, there are a couple of reasons. Here's the first reason. It's our broken human nature. You're broken, and I'm broken. And that's why you break promises. That's why you've broken vows in the past. That's why you break your finances. That's why you break relationships. Now, originally, that wasn't God's intent. In fact, God created this perfect environment, and it was a land of yes. And God said this to the first couple, Adam and Eve. He said, you can have everything, everything. And it's a land of yes, where God would protect, God would provide, and it's a perfect place. And God is not a God of rules, but God had one rule. And in the very center of the garden, why in the center of the garden does it say? Because in the center of the garden, it's symbolic of what is at the center of your life. Because at the center of your life, biblically speaking, God says, is the center of your will and your deepest desires. The Bible calls it your heart. And when you see the heart, and when you see the word heart used in the Bible, it's talking about the center of your will and your deepest desires. In fact, God says this, when we seek the Lord with all of our heart, he will give you the desires of your heart. Isn't that amazing? God is concerned about what's at the center of your life and of your desire, deepest desires. So at the center of the garden was this fruit. And God said, look, everything is yours. And God's not a God of rule, but he had one rule, because there had to be a relationship based on trust. Any healthy relationship has to be based on trust. And there was just one rule that they were told to obey. And here's the amazing thing about your enemy and mine. Satan's strategy, excuse me, is not to point out all the good things that you have, but to point out the one thing that you do not have. Has God said? God is not good. He's holding back from you. God's holding back from you the one thing that you need to have enough. In fact, the one thing that you don't have is the one thing that you need to be happy. And all of us, in one area or another, at one time or another, have been broken by our cravings and selfishness. One thing you need, just one thing more to be happy. a different job, a different spouse, different kids, a different home, better looks. I mean, the list just goes on and on. And it's, once again, it's not to do away with ambition. But here's a question. What's the one thing that you need and must, and that you must finally have to be happy? What's the one thing that you need to finally be happy? And I mentioned it earlier. I was perfectly happy until I saw what you have. And now I'm miserable. Because all of a sudden, when you tell yourself that you need something, you got to have it. Well, I need that. So Solomon, you know, going back to Solomon, I mentioned we'd come back to him. So Solomon wrote about this in a book called Ecclesiastes. And so the reference in your note sheet. And you know, the first thing that Solomon mentions when he talks about this pursuit, you know, how can he find contentment? How can he find real purpose and meaning in life? How can he find something that will finally make him happy? So he pursues everything under the sun because he had the position, the power, and the means to do so. And so this is the first thing that Solomon mentions. You know what he mentions? The first thing is this, physical health. Because Solomon realized without physical health, right? Nothing else really matters. So Solomon says, make sure that you're as physically healthy, and that's not a bad thing at all, but make sure that you're as physically healthy as you can be. But then he puts it in perspective, and he says this, generations come and go. So if you make physical health the one thing you need to be happy, it's ultimately a fool's game. Because Solomon is saying, what happens to everyone? You die. Whether you die at 40, 60, 70, 80, it's the one thing that happens to everyone. And it's amazing when we begin to just put it in perspective. The more perspective we have on this matter, the greater our life becomes in being fulfilled and really content here and then eternally focused. Across the street from the house that we currently live in, we've been there about 13 years or so, but we had a great neighbor who lived across the street, and he was a good neighbor, and he died a couple of years ago of cancer. He was a great guy, and I miss him. And I used to see him. He'd be getting the mail. Now his widow gets the mail. And so I would see him get the mail, and, you know, if I saw him, we'd say hi, and we'd talk a little bit, and now I see his widow once in a while. She's getting the mail. And now in the home that we live in, I usually get the mail. And so when I get home, whether it's that night or the next day, I'll get the mail. So I walk out. But here's the realization that one day, somebody else will be living in our home. One day. And somebody else will be getting the mail. So one day, someone who owns the house after me will be getting the mail. So here's the thing to put it in perspective. The only thing that outlives us all is the mail. I mean, you know, how insignificant, right? And what Solomon is saying here, just get a clue. Enough. Just one more thing. So it's our broken human nature. It just whacks our perspective out. Here's the next thing. Our American culture. Now I love America. I really do. And I pray for our country and for our nation on a regular basis. But our American culture, here's why, because our culture just plays into this. And when it comes to contentment, as an example, no one wants to be accused of being content because the word equals laziness or no drive or no ambition. Now, we've already talked about that. We saw biblically that that's not the case, but that's how people equate it. So if someone in your work says, this about you because you're hoping for a promotion. And if somebody says this about you, well, you know, he or she, they're just content where they're at. Is that a good or a bad thing in the culture that we live in if you want that promotion? It's a bad thing, isn't it? And here's a verse that goes against the grain of most in our culture. The reference is in your note sheet, but it's this. If we have food and clothing, we will be content with that. Pretty powerful verse, isn't it? And it goes against the grain of the culture that we live in. Now, I love America. I love our culture. When we've traveled overseas, I can't wait to get back. But let's put that verse into context. It's 1 Timothy chapter 6, where Paul is now mentoring a young pastor, a guy by the name of Tim. And Paul's just starting out. But he says this to Tim as he writes this letter. He says, godliness with contentment is great gain. That's a financial term. That's profitable. Godliness with contentment is great gain. And then he begins to put it in perspective. He says this, for we brought nothing into the world and we can take nothing out of it. But if we have food and clothing, we will be content with that. And then he goes on to unpack it further. He says, people who want to get rich, meaning that's at the center of their will and of their desire. It's the center, that's the garden of their life. People who want to get rich fall into temptation and a trap, into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge men and women into ruin and destruction. So not a week goes by, oftentimes not a day goes by, that you don't see some kind of a crime committed or crimes, horrible, horrific crimes. Why? Motivated out of greed that plunge men and women into ruin and destruction. For the love of money, the love of it, is the root of all kinds of evil. Some people, eager for money, have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs. Now, it's not being fatalistic and deciding to have no ambition. That's not it at all. In fact, I want to come back to this just a little bit and unpack it, because the Bible has a lot to say about this, about having a work ethic and being having character when it comes to the workplace and doing our jobs and et cetera, et cetera. So I love what Solomon, this guy, who God gave incredible wisdom because he asked God for wisdom. And in Proverbs chapter 24, he says this. He said, I went past the field of a sluggard. I love that word. Sluggard. It just kind of sounds like a person who's slow. But he said, I went past the field of a sluggard. You know, slug kind of moves along. Past the vineyard of a person who lacks judgment. Thorns had come up everywhere, and the ground was covered with weeds, and the stone wall was in ruins. And I applied my heart to what I observed, and I learned a lesson from what I saw. So he's looking at this guy. A little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to rest, and poverty will come on you like a bandit, and scarcity like an armed man. I love this. Another proverb, 13:4. It's how life usually works. Proverbs are not promises. They're statements about how life usually and generally works. He says this, lazy people want much but get little, while the diligent are prospering. Now listen very carefully. It doesn't mean that every poor person is lazy, but it does mean every lazy person will be poor. And that's why the two disciplines that we've talked about before, generosity and moderation, are so important. Because generosity turns our hearts towards the center of our will and desires, towards eternal things. And that's what Jesus said. Jesus said, where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. And if my whole life is to acquire, 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 then my life will be the total sum of my possessions rather than relationships, first with God and those who are closest to me. And there will always be a bigger and better mousetrap. And the more we need something, the more we want something. Let's bring it home. Here's some take-home things in the next few moments. So how do I get this contentment and how do I keep it? So here's the first thing, and I've already mentioned it, but let's bring it home. Change what you can and accept what you can't. Change what you can and accept what you can't. If you can change it, change. But if it's out of your control, pray about changing it. So if you're in a position, maybe where somebody says, and this could be a whole message based on the Word of God too, if somebody says, you know, if you were to get more education here, that would, well, get more education if you can. So if you can change it, change it. If you can't, pray about changing it and taking the next step. And that's why we have, whether it's your parenting skills, we have parent on purpose. Whether it's in the area of your finances, we have financial peace. That's why we have growth groups, to pray for each other and to lean on each other and to seek wise counsel and advice. So change what you can, accept what you can't. Number two, avoid your contentment and Thanksgiving killers. And they're different for every single one of us. And so if there is an area of your life that you are discovering you cannot change, what are you exposing your thinking and your life to that will cause greater discontent? And so, if I know that I am not in a position to get a bigger screen TV, I avoid the section in Costco. I am pathetic. You know that anyway. It's just, but they're different for all of us. And number three, treat every situation as a special assignment from God. What a difference that will make. And it's back to what we said earlier. How can I bring glory to you today, God? And He gives us strength one day at a time. And the more that I plug into Jesus Christ, the more independent from outside circumstances I become. And we learn and we grow in gratitude and contentment. I love this psalm. Let me read it to you, and then we're going to read one together. It says this, I bless the holy name of my God with all my heart. Yes, I will bless the Lord and not forget the glorious things He does for me. He forgives all my sins, and He heals me. He ransoms me from hell. He surrounds me with loving kindness and tender mercies. He fills my life with good things. My youth is renewed like the eagles. You want to be thankful? Of course we do. That's why you're here, to give thanks to God. Look at this psalm, and then let's read it together. It's up on the board here, right? Yes, it is. All right. Here it is. Let's read it together. You ready? This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Give thanks to the Lord, for He is good. His love endures forever. Did you sense the excitement beginning to build a little bit? A little bit? All right, let's read it again. One more time, let's read it. This is the day, and the excitement builds. Here we go. All right, it's getting big. All right, here we go. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Give thanks to the Lord, for He is good. His love endures forever. Let's give the Lord a clap offering. We love you, Lord. And we give you praise and glory and honor. Grateful people, this is what every study shows, that grateful people make a list of at least three things, whether it's mentally, and we have these amazing notes, you know, on our phones, most of you do, or in your Bible, whatever, and grateful people make a list of at least three things that they're thankful for every day. And then they remind themselves throughout the course of that whole day about those three things. The next day, three more things. It's a challenge and it's a commitment that if you make, it will begin to remap your brain in ways that you cannot imagine. When I came to know the Lord, there was a song that we sang. It was a long time ago, and it's still sung. But it's the lyrics are this: count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God has done. Amen.
Yes.
Amen.